already have discussed in the last lectures. The first, I tried to explain what is generally meant usually by quantum criticality, and the picture on the first slide was just that, which actually is not so much interesting, because if you have two phases, then you still have two phases. The only thing that you have some non-trivial critical behavior in the region of a quantum critical point, which was at some point of axis of the tuning parameter, like doping or something like that. So then slowly we have moved to cuprates, which the number of opinions about cuprates is huge. One of them was also from the beginning, that in principle, in these cuprates, this is the structure of one of them, the most important thing that there is some lattice consisting of two-dimensional layers with the elementary cell consisting of copper atoms and oxygens. So these are copper atoms and oxygens. And basically, already for 25 years, people speak of phase diagram. Of course, if one goes into details, it is considerably more complicated. The point is that if you do not dope these atoms, you have antiferromagnet, you have a very good antiferromagnetic state with quantum fluctuations and so on. But with doping, adding more holes or electrons, this is just half filled band, and this antiferromagnet is something like spin up and spin down on copper atoms. You have copper atoms, and you have spin up, spin down, and all this forms antiferromagnet state at a small doping. If you add electrons or holes, this antiferromagnetic state is destroyed fairly fast. So several percent is sufficient to destroy additional holes or electrons is sufficient to destroy the antiferromagnetic state. What happens then? So in principle, there are two effects. If you destroy the antiferromagnet just in the model where all electrons are bound, sit at some places and only spins fluctuate, then if you destroy such an antiferromagnet state, okay, you destroy spin order. And not so much happens with the motion of electrons, they are still bound. So here, what happens is more complicated. Because not only the antiferromagnetic order, not only spin ordering is destroyed when you add more electrons or holes in the system. In addition, there are additional electrons, and if you are exactly in the half filled band case, this means that you have only one electron, additional electron to one copper atom, then they just sit. Then you add more electrons, and then in principle already there is possibility that these additional electrons start moving around the lattice. They hop into oxygen, and oxygen atoms are in between. And then they hop into tunnel into oxygen atoms, then into copper, and they can move through the system. So there are two effects, actually, spin effect and electron motion. So, and what happens? From the point of, just experiment was discovered just in the beginning, almost 25 years ago, that already going with tuning, with doping, one comes into this superconducting phase, which with very high transition temperature, and this is And then soon after, it was more or less realized from experimentally that this superconductivity is hardly due to conventional phonon mechanism, although even now there are people who speak of phonon mechanisms, but my feeling is that their number is decaying. Anyway, I don't want to speak about phonons. And another possibility was discussed also from the beginning, that in principle there is antiferromagnet, and there are, if you destroy the antiferromagnet, there are some paramagnons, so still fluctuations. I wrote this Lagrangian for fluctuating field, and it was something like Ginzburg-Landau expansion. This was gradient, and here pi squared term, and then there was a phi squared, and then there was d phi d tau squared with some coefficient. There was also this Ginzburg-Landau quartic term. So, and this is the field which exists even in the disordered phase. So if A is positive, then one has here this fluctuation, fluctuating field phi. This fluctuating field is of the kind of antiferromagnetic fluctuations. If A is negative, as usual in the Landau theory of phase transitions, you get ordered antiferromagnetic phase. But otherwise, this is just these fluctuations. And what also was, so there were proposals almost in the beginning, that in principle, these fluctuations of the antiferromagnetic field, they can be the source of interaction between electrons. And then this is why the superconductivity should appear. There were such proposals, and of course, what people did, they used just conventional Bardeen-Schreffer-Cooper theory of superconductivity, replacing phonons by these paramagnets. And then interaction electron paramagnet interaction. Leads to so-called D-wave pairing. And what is that? This is just the symmetry of wave function for the superconductor. Usually the BCS theory, one has so-called S-wave pairing, which means that one has so that this superconducting function for S pairing is almost constant as a function of vector upon the Fermi surface. So this is M, it characterizes the vector on the Fermi surface. It is constant for S wave, for conventional superconductivity. And it has a rather tricky picture of that type if you are in D-wave pairing. So here plus, here plus, minus. So this means that there is a certain dependence on the angle of this pairing. And just if one has this exchange by paramagnets, this should lead, not necessarily lead, but there is a tendency to formation of D-wave pairing, of D-wave superconductivity. So everything would be nice, but there were first many different experiments. Second, there were powerful theoreticians who were proposing different mechanisms. So therefore, the field didn't really move to any consensus for almost 25 years.
Can you be a bit more precise about those theories?
Okay, this paramagnon, first possibility of D-wave pairing was, so this paramagnon. Magnon and D-wave. This was even proposed even before ITC. Before the discovery of ITC, it was Colapino. Then I guess already after discovery of ITC superconductors, before ITC.
Before
ITC is Colapino. Then, after, I would say that it was Pines with his people. There are several of them. It was more or less BCS theory of superconductivity. This group simply were replacing phonons by paramagnons using more or less BCS formula and messaging some parameters. They could get critical temperature and so on. So it was sharply. So there was another powerful theory, which is due to Phil Anderson. It was a so-called RVB, random valence bond theory. I don't want to go into details about this theory because it is actually completely different. So the mechanisms of superconductivity due to this was completely different from conventional BCS. So in BCS theory, Baden-Cooper-Schrieffer, you have electrons paired into two electrons paired into Cooper pair. And this is just what Pinesmith people were proposing. So from Anderson picture, it was a completely different story. And the problem was in this theory, for example, that here one could work saying that we have some small coupling and we could develop conventional BCS theory, whether it is proper for cuprates or not, one could not say, but nevertheless, so one could calculate something. So here, this was intuitive thing. Everything was set from the beginning by Anderson. It is strongly coupling theory. Therefore, one could not do some explicit calculations except writing Hubbard model and doing numerics. But this was an evident obstacle due to this famous sign problem in the Monte Carlo simulations. Otherwise, one could do not theories, but proposals based on some intuition, and people were saying, no, this is should be this scenario, let us compare with the experiment. And another were saying that let us propose this scenario and compare with another an experiment. And so the situation, so if one was watching from outside what is going on, it was really the war of everybody with everybody. So nobody could agree, so all these people, Anderson Pines and then Schrieffer at that time, they have become immediately enemies and so on. And the problem was that the number of experiments was growing, number of experimental facts very often contradicting to each other was growing, a number of proposals also was growing, so, and already I displayed once that already in a number of publications in 2005 was something of the order of 100,000 publications. Okay, I don't think that since then the order has changed. Maybe here it is still 5, but the factor may be already quite large. But there was really not so much consensus on what is going on. And then, in addition to superconductivity, so-called pseudo-gap state was found in experiments. So in principle, one can cite here Alul just in nearby laboratory, but some people say that there was even an experiment by Warren. This I heard from Lutakon. And he showed in Les Abrilettes, he has shown just the paper by Warren. It was also in the MAR. And it was before Alul. And well, one can check. So he told explicitly and showed this paper.
This part will have to be cut on.
So anyway, this pseudo gap state is of no doubt, and this means that you have not really metal, but you have some kind of gap in the metallic spectrum. And the problem was that the origin of this pseudo-gap was unclear, really remained unclear again for almost 25 years. Some people were speaking in terms of that these are preformed Cooper pairs, that you have superconductor, but then you have here very strong fluctuations, and these Cooper pairs are not real Cooper pairs, but somehow fluctuating Cooper, the virtual Cooper pairs, and this is pseudo-gap state. Yeah.
Sorry, why pseudo-gap?
Because one couldn't somehow identify any order to which this was gap. Then it was somehow soft. It was not sharp gap, so that at some point of spectrum you have sharp gap. Mm-hmm. It was somehow deep, I would say, in density of states and so on. So,
but therefore, the question is still open, whether it's due to fluctuations or whether it's a true ordered order. It's still open. Apparently after 25 years people think it's more a gap.
Well, I guess that more or less now already more or less people have agreed that now this is not preformed Cooper pair.
Yeah, it's more gap than pseudo. Pseudo is
yeah. And this is just a very rough diagram. If you then experiments discovered that there were some stripes and this stripe structure, and this stripe consisted of both of spin and charge involved, and this was somehow in this part of the phase diagram. And so if one starts listing all these experiments and all experimental facts, then okay, this is, if roughly say that the number of theoretical papers is equal to the one of experimental, then it
you
will
think
be
so?
No, only 50.
I don't think so.
So
there's less theoretical papers.
Less theoretical papers.
I think.
Okay, so therefore it just makes no sense to give overview of those things. So the problem is that with theory, really there were practically no theories that would really use conventional methods of theoretical physics, which means that you formulate a Hamiltonian and you try to solve it either analytically or numerically, getting some. Because it was decided from the beginning that this theory, strong coupling theory. So therefore, any calculation is somehow makes no sense. Therefore, one should simply guess scenario. And that's why people couldn't really agree on that. And moreover, the number of experiments showing more and more. Data of new facts was growing, and even just last year, so 2 years ago, some completely new facts have been discovered. It was discovered that apparently this superconducting phase is competing with some charge order. So no antiferromagnetism, no spins, but some charge order exists. So already have talked, so we'll mention, have mentioned about that. So therefore, in that sense, other proposals were also on market. There are proposals about orbital currents existing in this copper oxide phases. I'm not sure that derivation of superconductivity from orbital currents so it satisfies this old-fashioned taste that one formulates Hamiltonian and derives the superconductivity. So everywhere it was some either non-controlled mean field theory or some kind of guesses. So then I guess just returning to this, so I can be unfair, but I simply cannot review all possible approaches. But Katrina have been in this field for much longer time than me, and I believe that she can agree that most of theoretical publications were proposals rather than theories.
Yeah, with maybe exception of
GMFT. Okay, but their results couldn't somehow explain the origin of the gap.
Yes. No, but okay.
And also superconductivity, I guess.
Yeah, it's a complex field.
Okay, so then what was the development of this PINES activity? It was, I guess, the model was formulated, which was somehow still half phenomenological, and this is spin fermion model. So that's what I already have spent some time last, and the people who. So I guess Andrei Chubukov was the main proponent of this spin fermion model, but again he did postdoc with PINES, so I believe that his love to this model, so his love to this idea of paramagnetic ideas, maybe also due to PINES, but they formulated a model which was somehow more more better formulated than what Pines did. And this is spin fermion model. This is, and I already have shown it last time. That it is formulated in such a way that one has these paramagnons, which I have written, but in addition to just purely spin degrees of freedom, one has some fermions or electrons moving on the Fermi surface and interacting with these paramagnons. So what is written here, it is just d tau, this is time derivative, then this is the spectrum, and this is the interaction between this paramagnon and the spin of the electron. So this is the Lagrangian, and actually that's all. So in addition to this critical field of describing these antiferromagnetic fluctuations, one adds electrons, which is somewhat phenomenological, because one can start from the beginning with the Hubbard model, for example, or other model, and one can ask where is this model. So antiferromagnetism is obtained already from the Hubbard model. Why should one consider separately this paramagnons and electrons on this matrix? One can argue in such a way that one integrates over some high energies, and these high energies say 1000 Kelvin and higher, so that the Fermi energy is of the order of 10,000 Kelvin. So therefore one integrates everything high energies, one describes in this way antiferromagnetic transition, and then on top of that one has some low energy excitations still, although the transition temperature of superconductivity is high, 100 Kelvin, still it is much lower than Fermi energy, which is 10,000 Kelvin. And therefore, for low energies, one has these paramagnons, but plus interacting with electrons. So, until now, I do not know how one can derive this, which assumptions one can derive this low energy theory from, say, Hubbard model or Cotterill lattice. But let us suppose that this is so. So this is, and then let us try to solve this model already using some well-developed methods like mean field theory, like then fluctuations will be described by kind of a sigma model, and then one can study already properties of the sigma model using the fluctuation, using renormalization group. So now already I have started to talk about that people in principle have studied. So Andrei Chubukov and the co-authors here were studying this model maybe from the beginning of 2000s. And many properties of normal state have been studied, instability to superconductivity was found, and everything could be nicely described, provided one wrote here not one field, a fermionic field, but many fermionic, n fermionic, large n fermionic fields. And this large n was helping to do everything in a controlled way. A lambda, small parameter here, one can do it, small coupling limit formula. But in principle, this parameter scales out at the critical point, as usual.
Could you present what is n?
One writes here the sum over alpha, and each psi has a subscript alpha.
So some colors,
and this is sum of all alpha. That means so many fields, many Fermi surfaces of the same.
Flavors.
So a large number of flavors. Then it helped. And then the conclusion of all these works was that for large n limit, one can come to a very good description, so the Liardi time description of superconductivity. This means that one can take into account renormalization of Green functions, but neglect renormalization of vertices, which is usually done for phonons. Here it could be done in this way. And one, the problem was that with studying this model, one could calculate many things, and one could compare with some experiments. But there was also a problem in terms of applying this model to superconductors, and the point was that this pseudo-gap state didn't show up at all, and one could argue only that these are preformed Cooper pairs, but experimentally it is not so. So therefore, there was in last years some kind of stagnation. Everything has been calculated, but at the same time, many experimental features remained unclear. And then also Subir Sajdev was always the proponent of this critical behavior, that the criticality is responsible for the superconducting phase. But independent of the Cooper rates, this model was revisited somehow several years ago by Mitlitsky and Sajdev, and after some work of Sinsuk Lee, the point was that some diagrams have been found in the expansion, which really were not small for large n limit. And then it was clear that the previous analysis is not complete. And also they pointed out an approximate SU2 symmetry and some instability to some new instability. And actually this was our starting point after I came last year to Sakhalin. So these dangerous diagrams that were found were just such letters.
Okay, can you precise where they
couple
on the Fermi surface? Which part?
As concerns these hot spots, I already spoke last time. These are hot spots. So this vector q is pi divided by a. A is lattice constant. So, and this paramagnon, as it is antiferromagnetic, and antiferromagnet has the period, which is double of the period of the lattice, then it has this vector q. This is reciprocal in momentum space. This q corresponds to double period of the original lattice. And if this term scatters, if one writes it in Fermi in momentum representation, this is some momentum here, and then this phi scatters by vector q to another point of Fermi surface. We want to consider the Fermi surface. And then you can connect, so there is vector Q, but also the same vector Q is perpendicular to this one, because everything you can add here, so for example, you're writing minus P divided by A, and this is the same vector, just because it is different by 2 pi divided by A. We are on the lattice, and we have brilliant zone, and we have periodicity. So therefore, there is this vector Q, and there is the perpendicular vector Q. So, and then, which one? No, this one. And then there are regions in the Fermi surface which are called hot spots, in the sense that this vector Q or this vector Q, that they, this one, they match exactly with this here. So this point matches with this one, this here, and in perpendicular direction. There are 8 so-called hot spots. So now, these are most important regions in this model, and what Subir Sajdev and Metlitsky, Maxim Metlitsky, have demonstrated, that if you consider electrons near these hot spots, and you, if you study these ladders, so these ladders is some more or less superconductivity. But also, the problem arises if one considers this ferro in this direction, the other in this direction, and this is already something new, which is particle hole.
Question: my question was just to put what hotspot enters.
What hotspot enters?
You could draw on the blackboard.
Also on the blackboard. If I write here this. This, then hotspots are here. This superconducting is connecting, for example, this is point 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Then if you take for superconductivity, as usual, for superconductivity, you have to take momenta, opposite momenta. And therefore, one, for example, one of them corresponds to 3 prime, and this is 1, and then it scatters from 3 prime, it scatters to 1 prime, and then in the opposite, 1 scatters into 3. And then again, 1 prime scatters into 3 prime, and 3 scatters into 1, and you have such a letter. So this is pairing between these two. So what is here? It is actually the same. You can direct this way, and you can write the same in this way. And again, you write the same things. And 3, and here 1, 3, 1, and it doesn't matter. The direction of these arrows doesn't matter, just because this vector Q, and this is vector Q each time, that vector Q is equal to minus Q, actually. Q is equal to minus Q. So it doesn't matter, you take pi divided by A, or you take minus pi divided by A. divided by A. So in both cases, you can write the same. So, and what is that? In principle, it is such type of some kind of electron hole pairing. This is electron hole pairing. This is pairing of two electrons, and this is still, I don't want to speak about pairing because this is some kind of indication of instability. And this can happen that such diagram is also can lead to some pairing in case if one has nesting. It is also known fact, and there are some insulators that can arise due to that. And here you see that the direction of arrows doesn't matter, and this means that you have symmetry. So you can write everything in terms of some doublets. So your field is not only high, it is high complex conjugate and high. And if you consider two-on-two matrices, rotations of this field, the initial Hamiltonian is invariant under these rotations, which is reflected here. You can change the sign of the arrow, and the sign of the arrow means that you change complex conjugate to a real thing, and there is a certain invariance. And of course, this invariance is only proximate. And this is approximate if you assume that here, near the hot spot, everything is more or less flat. Of course, it is not. But approximately, you understand that your interaction here is singular. So you see that this is 1 divided by q minus q. So this propagator of interaction is singular. And this is small, small q close to this capital Q. So this is very peaked in the momentum space. And if it is very peaked in the momentum space, this means that you have scattering from here to here, but in very narrow region. And if so, narrow region is always almost flat. So that's, and therefore, this is not a wonder that here one has also electron hole pairing. So this fact has been noticed first by in this work, and this symmetry was noticed. Of course, if one takes into account the curvature here, this is only proximate symmetry. So there is no such complete symmetry. But if one looks into that paper and subsequent paper, it was viewpoint in physical review, this publication. There was subsequent paper by Andrei Chubukov who praised this work. And the idea was that this symmetry can be very important for forming critical behavior, for forming corresponding exponents and so on. So they still were speaking in terms of critical behavior. So now already our starting point was addressed different. This had not been discussed, such possibility before us, that all these diagrams look much like those diagrams that I drew during my first 5 lectures here, which were diffusions and cooperons in the localization theory. And then, of course, why not to try just doing that scheme. If we have such diagrams and they can be somehow interact with each other, so one can speak in terms of these excitations, interacting excitations, why not to try another approach borrowed from localization theory and described in that way, and to see whether there is a possibility of a small parameter that would justify all these things. So really do the theory, not just, again, qualitative discussion. And it turned out that everything is possible. So large unlimit doesn't help really for those diagrams. And therefore one had to find a small parameter if one wants to make really clean theory. So, and this small parameter was found actually. So as usual, if one wants to solve some good theoretical model, and if one doesn't see a possibility exactly solving it as it stands, let us try a model which is a little bit different, but close to this one. So therefore, what we assumed, instead of this realistic model, let us study some kind of Fermi surface of that way. So the difference is that here this edges or this part of spectrum is deviates in that direction, like here. This is somehow small distortion of Fermi surface, but it was purely for finding a small parameter that would allow us to do everything analytically, using small parameter, using everything under control. So we assumed such kind of Fermi surface. Hot spots are here. The only difference that if we have such thing, the possibility that Fermi velocities that are perpendicular to the Fermi surface here, that the Fermi velocities V1 and V2 are close in the direction. So the angle between them was supposed to be small. That was a little bit artificial, but small parameter of the theory. And I want to emphasize that really using this small parameter, we managed to make the analysis of the model explicitly and justifying all steps done, getting some results, and I will tell about that, and at the end, with a big surprise, realizing that some experiments have been done just a year before, and several experiments can well favor our theoretical picture. So maybe I will make a break. And so therefore, we consider now this model, spin fermion model, with such a Fermi surface, but this is artificial for the sake of having some small parameter. Of course, at the end, if you want to apply that model to this realistic Fermi surface, we should take delta of the order of 1. So even somehow, very often, it is close to pi half. So if velocity is here in that direction, here in that direction. But we hope that qualitatively everything works. And one can already study the predictions of solving this model. Okay, let us make the break now.